reduce ejection fraction, particularly those who have got diabetes. So we all know that heart failure has been a serious challenge across the globe because of the two important facts. Those patients who are admitted with heart failure, 50% of them do get readmission within 6 months, which is a very short time. And at least 50% of people with heart failure, 50% of the patients with heart failure die within 5 years. Now, this problem or heart failure with diabetes is a bigger challenge in India because of a variety of reasons. Number one, there are a large number of patients and they're increasing on a daily basis. Many patients who have heart failure in India are young. Many of them have diabetes. So the people who form the heart failure group, out of which people with diabetes is a big number. Readmission rate and death because of the heart failure has been quite high in India. And a very important point is the rate at which medications are given or the optimum medications which are prescribed is quite less. So because of all of this, more and more patients need readmission to hospital, as well as more and more patients do need to have a variety of treatment updation or emergency room visits because of the failure. Now, we know that heart failure and diabetes, when they two coexist, it becomes a strong predictor of adverse outcomes. You take the chart on the left of your screen, and these are the data obtained from the various heart failure trial. Now, in all this heart failure trial, with whatever intervention which was done, patients or people who had diabetes, let's come to people who did not have diabetes, had a higher chance of getting admission for the hospital with heart failure. So if you look to the totality of data, roughly 1.5 to 1.9 times higher risk of readmission with the patients who have got diabetes and heart failure. On the right of your screen, there is data of diabetes trials where patients were treated with various diabetes drugs. And based on whether they had heart failure to begin with or they did not have heart failure, the risk of admission is different. The patients who did not have heart failure to begin with versus patients who had heart failure to begin with, they had at least 3 to 4 times higher risk of admission. So meaning to say that when diabetes and heart failure, they two coexist, there is much more chance of having adverse outcomes. So simply, the goals of therapy in patients with heart failure are three important points. Number one, we know that people of heart failure die either because of sudden cardiac death or they die because of the progressive pump failure. So by whatever means, by whatever medications and non-medical efforts, our idea is to make them live longer. The second point, which is very, very important, is to reduce risk of readmission to hospitals because it is very unpleasant and a serious psychological trauma, not only to patients, but families also. It adds a lot of cost. And apart from that, it itself is a bad prognostic marker because those who need admission to hospital with heart failure, they've got higher mortality in the future. And third point, which is very important, we want patients to improve their symptoms and have adequate quality of life so that they can live unrestricted and normal life. Now, in my talk today, I'm going to concentrate on the second point, that is, we're going to talk all those therapies and modalities which can reduce the risk of HHF. Now, we know that a patient of heart failure needs admission for heart failure because of a variety of reasons. Many of are well known to us, like say, for example, starting from as simple as fluid excess and exertion, to various co-medications like NSAID, to certain serious events like infections or acute coronary syndrome. But one very important point leading to HHF is suboptimal treatment. Now, this is the data before 3-4 years. At that time, ACE inhibitors or ARB were the standard line of treatment for heart failure, not ARNI, which was not available at that time. So if you look to the patients who at the time of discharge, number of patients who were on ACE inhibitors or ARB was less than 50%. Number of patients who were on beta blockers were less than 55-56%. And patients who were on aldosterone antagonists, they were less than 50%. So overall, 25-30% at max patients used to receive the combined triple therapy, which was the standard of care at that time. So this is very important to keep on adding the medications which have proven data to reduce mortality and HHF. So let's study various medications step by step. We know that beta blockers, particularly metoprolol, sustained release, bisoprolol and carvedilol are the drugs which have a solid data of reducing mortality as well as reducing risk of worsening of heart failure and requirement of admissions. A point here to be mentioned very carefully is just a microdose of beta blocker is not good enough. It's very important to build up the dose of beta blocker. So once your patient is on beta blocker, our idea is to take the resting heart rate to as low as 60 per minute. Obviously, we need to take care of certain issues in terms of blood pressure and other aspects. But if a patient can tolerate this drug, it has to go to a level where heart rate comes down to as low as 60 per minute at resting. The second group of drug we all know this is aldosterone antagonist. It has also a solid data of reducing mortality and reducing need of HHF. This is the data from EMPhASIS HF, where eplerenone was tested in heart failure patients with mild symptoms, and there was significant reduction in the primary composite endpoint, where HHF was significantly reduced. Now, is this drug effective in both the group of patients, that is, patients who have diabetes versus patients who do not have diabetes? So look at the benefits here. In this trial, the overall benefit in the primary composite endpoint was significant, but still more robust benefit was obtained in the people who had diabetes. So meaning to say that when you use aldosterone antagonists in people with diabetes with HFrEF, you are going to get mortality benefit as well as morbidity benefit in terms of HHF. Now, ACE inhibitors and ARB have got good data about treatment of HHF. ACE inhibitors has got more robust data, but now with the advent of ARNI, we know that ARNI has become the drug of choice. And this was a landmark trial, PARADIGM-HF, which was wonderfully conducted, where ARNI up to the dose of 200 milligram twice a day versus ACE inhibitors, time-tested ramipril, I mean enalapril, 10 milligram twice a day, were compared in patients who had stable heart failure between class 2 to 4, ejection fraction less than 40%. We all know that primary composite endpoint, that is CV death and HF admission, was reduced significantly. And if you look to the individual endpoint, that is HHF, that was also very significantly reduced when patients were given ARNI instead of ACE inhibitors. So ARNI proved to be much superior to ACE inhibitors as far as HHF reduction is concerned. Now, it's very important to build up the dose of ARNI. Many times what we see in the physician's prescription that they start ARNI and then they are a little afraid to build up the dose. Generally, most of the patients do receive 50 milligram twice a day. Now, there is a significant amount of data that when you increase the dose of ARNI from 50 milligram BD to 100 milligram BD to 200 milligram BD, provided patient tolerates in terms of blood pressure and potassium, there is extra benefit. So try to chase and maximize the dose of ARNI if the patient is tolerating as far as BP is concerned. At this point, I would like to make another point is blood pressure reading in terms of numerical reading, that is 95, 96, or 90 systolic, you shouldn't be worried to push up the dose of ARNI because of two things. Number one, those patients who have got a BP of 95 without any symptoms of postural hypertension or without any symptoms of reduced perfusion or fatigue, that blood pressure is well tolerated. And second, on many occasions, we have seen that when you build up the dose of ARNI to higher, in fact, the heart failure improves, and that's why blood pressure also improves. So a very strong message I would like to convey here is it's not only the number of blood pressure by which you should be guided to build up the dose of ARNI. Keep on building the dose if patient keeps on tolerating the drug. Now, ARNI is very effective in reducing the primary composite endpoint, that is CV death and HHF. Both of them are individually also reduced in patients who have got diabetes or those who do not have diabetes. So look at your right side. This is the data of HF admission, where whether patients have diabetes or patient has normoglycemia, roughly there is 20% risk reduction in patients for HHF. That brings us to the fourth molecule, which has been well discussed throughout the conference as well as in this session also. But I have to touch this topic. That's why I'm making two, three slides for this. SGLT2 inhibitors has a robust data that it reduces HHF admissions. Now, initially, when the trials for CVOTs with SGLT inhibitors were done, they showed consistent effect. You take all the trials, whether empagliflozin, dapagliflozin, canagliflozin, or vortiglifloxacin, the HHF was reduced irrespective of the fact that whether patient had ASCVD or patient did not have ASCVD, as well as whether patient had heart failure to begin with or normal ejection fraction to begin with. So any patient and every patient of diabetes who were tested in this trial had a strong benefit as far as HHF is concerned, irrespective of certain other baseline qualifications. That's how the science went to test this molecule in patients with established heart failure. And we all know that both the molecules, empagliflozin and dapagliflozin, did suggest there is significant reduction in primary composite endpoint in patients with heart failure, irrespective of the fact whether patient has diabetes or not. In fact, both this trial, if you take the HHF alone, hospitalization for heart failure, both of these trials showed a significant reduction in the patients of heart failure who received SGLT2 inhibitors. A very important point from DAPA-HF trial, and which is also true to most extent with Vextent for empagliflozin also, that benefit was irrespective of so many things. Whether patient had diabetes or whatever the HbA1c level to start with, patients had benefit. Irrespective of the renal function up to the eGFR of 20 or 30, patient had benefit. Irrespective of the systolic blood pressure, whether it was starting BP was more than 100 or less than 100, there was benefit to the patients in terms of HHF. Many patients do receive a variety of agents. Many of them are on ARNI, and many of them have devices. So all those patients who had devices, all those patients who had ARNI, or all those patients who had direct therapy, they all had benefit because of the addition of this treatment. And this benefit was irrespective of the etiology of heart failure. So whether your patient has got ischemic heart failure or non-ischemic heart failure, when you add on SGLT2 inhibitors, they are going to get benefit in terms of reduction in HHF. Another important point, addition of SGLT2 inhibitors is more effective to reduce HHF if a patient has a history of admission with heart failure in last 1 year. It is also effective in people who have got history of admission before 1 year, and it is also effective in people who do not have history of heart failure admission. But more the seriousness or more the proximity to the last admission with heart failure, there is more benefit. What does it say? It means very clearly that any patient of heart failure who has at least one history of admission with heart failure, you must start SGLT2 inhibitor therapy as early as possible. Now, this slide, which was shown by Dr. Kamal Sharma, also is a slide, according to me, is a landmark slide. And that led to lot of discussions, debates, and how the chronology of treatment of heart failure be initiated. Now, if you look to the data of SGLT2 inhibitors in heart failure patients, whether DAPA-HF or EMPA-REG outcome, both of them did suggest that the benefit in terms of reduction in primary composite endpoint, and in specific HHF, it starts within 17 to 30 days. So here is a treatment when you start to your patients before 1 month, it starts giving benefit to the patients. And that's why the new recommendation of comprehensive therapy with four pillars of heart failure to be started as early as possible, to be started together, depending upon the patient's hemodynamics and kidney functions, is the way in today's world. I personally believe that all these four molecules should be started at least in 50% of patients. You can do that. That brings us to another molecule, that is evobradine. We all know that it doesn't form the part of four pillars of the treatment, but it's a very important treatment because those patients who have got moderate to severe heart failure, and in spite of the best possible dose of beta blockers whose resting heart rate is more than 70 beats per minute, when you add this drug, it reduces heart rate as well as it reduces composite endpoint, which is mainly driven by HHF. So this is a drug which many patients do get significant benefit because there are limitations of building up the dose of beta blockers to a level where you achieve a resting heart rate of less than 60 or 70. So this is quite widely used molecule. Vigitide is almost a forgotten molecule, but I personally believe it has some role as far as HHF is concerned. Obviously, the chronology of giving four important pillars of drugs is always there. Evobradine is always there. But if you look to the DICT trial, it did lead to reduction in risk of HHF and CHF mortality. Specifically, when you give a very small dose of digitalis to create a serum level between 0.5 to 1 nanogram of ml, that's where the arrhythmogenicity is less, that's where the arrhythmic number of death is less, and that's where you get a strong benefit. So there are a few patients in our country where I do use digitalis as an add-on treatment for heart failure. These are two newer molecules which are not available at the moment in India. And both of them have been tested in patients with severe heart failure, and the primary composite endpoint, that is heart failure admission and death, have been reduced by both of them. A very important point is this particular drug, Vericiguat, was tested, and I personally believe when it starts becoming available in our country, we can be using this molecule in patients who have repeated episodes of ADHF in spite of the best possible tolerated treatment. While this drug, which is quite BP neutral, and many patients of heart failure, as we discussed, have got borderline low blood pressure. So omecamtiv is a drug which can be given to even patients with low BP because that's where it doesn't affect the BP negatively. A word about certain device treatment. We all know that in certain subsets of patients who have got NYHA class 3 to 4 failure with ejection fraction less than 35%, dilated left ventricle, LBBB with certain QRS duration, CRT is going to help not only in terms of mortality reduction, but also in terms of reduction of heart failure admission. So those patients who fit into the criteria for putting the CRT devices plus minus ICD should be given this option. A wonderful new innovation which has been there in the last 5 to 10 years is many patients with either ischemic or non-ischemic cardiomyopathy, they do have dilatation of mitral annular, and that leads to severe mitral regurgitation because of the incomplete cooptation of mitral wall. That's where percutaneous repair of the mitral wall with the mitral clip does help you not only to reduce mortality, but also HHF in up to 2 years. So this is a new treatment, and there are definitely few patients who can get significant benefit out of this treatment. So ladies and gentlemen, coming to last 2-3 slides of my talk, if you discuss the evidence-based treatment for HFrEF, which leads to reduction in mortality. These are the treatments. And every patient, each and every patient, based on indication and ruling out the contraindication, should be on these drugs. ACE inhibitors and ARB are generally now out, and it is the ARNI which we are using because of the better benefit. But the patients who do not have access to ARNI because of various reasons, you can be still be using ACE inhibitors. 3 beta blockers have been well tested for HFrEF reduction in mortality in HHF. Aldosterone antagonists, you may be using spironolactone or leprinone. Those patients who where you cannot use the RAS inhibitions because of the hyperkalemia or certain other issues, hydralazine plus isosorbide dinitrate is a wonderful treatment. I mean, SL2 inhibitors is a wonderful add-on, which has we have learned in the last 2 to 3 years. CRT and ICD in those patients where it is needed. And as I discussed to you, mitraclip for the patients who have got dilated cardiomyopathy with severe mitral regurgitation. All this treatment which I discussed have also a significant data of reduction in risk of HHF. So all perhaps all the treatment which reduces mortality do have a strong data of reduction in need of repeat admission to the hospital. So all of these drugs should be used in patients with heart failure and diabetes. So coming to a sort of conclusion in one slide, number one, yes, we have to aim for reducing risk of HHF in patients who've got diabetes and HFrEF. No patients whose diabetes control is not good will be away from hospital. So it's very, very important to have a good control of glycemia and diabetes. Treating the cause is a very important point. You cannot be treating heart failure with whatever drugs and devices unless patient's underlying etiology is corrected. Lifestyle modifications, avoiding exertions, avoiding food and salt excess, a regular exercise training go a long way to keep the patient away from hospital and giving a good quality of life. There are certain monitoring methods by which you can predict the increasing PA pressure. It may be PA pressure measuring device, or there can be simple solution to that is daily weight chart to a patient. So when weight increases by 1.5 to 2 kilogram, there is a chance that patient has got extra water, and that's where additional dose of diuretic can keep the patient away from hospital. 4 pillars of treatment should be started simultaneously in all patients. Try your level best to give each of them, and try your level best to build up the dose of all these drugs, ARNI, beta blocker, aldosterone antagonist, and SGLT2 inhibitors. Add-on therapy in terms of evobradin, digitalis, lubdarix, isoleucine, verisuga, omecamtiv, etc. are available. Whatever is available, you can be trying in selected patients. CRT plus minus ICD has its own role. Mitraclip, Albert, etc. are important. A very important point at this stage I would like to mention is do answer the comorbid conditions, because many of them do lead the patients for repeat admissions. Treating hypertension to the lowest possible level, that is less than 130/80. If patient gets 110/70, it's still better. Taking care of anemia and iron deficiency is a very important part of keeping the patient away from hospital. Taking care of CKD and potassium, sleep disorder, breathing, COPD and atrial fibrillation, all of them needs to be answered very well. And last but not the least, a patient who has got heart failure with reduced ejection fraction, they do get benefit by flu vaccine and pneumonia vaccine. So all the patients of HFrEF, we should be having a holistic approach and should be giving, explaining them all of this and trying our level best to build up this treatment. With this, I'm pretty sure we can reduce the HHF in patients who have got HFrEF. Thank you very much for your kind attention.